The third game this time is Caveman Ninja, the first Johnny Mac game. As you can see, this is the digital version in the Johnny Turbo's arcade line. Now, every game I've talked about so far I've played for the first time, but discounting the Super Spy, which was just one game, this is a series I knew the least about before playing. The fact that the series lasted only 3 years and ended when I was only 2 years old didn't help. Like with Double Dragon, I do multiple playthroughs, three this time since there are three endings. First one with long-suffering player 2, one by myself, and one more co-op playthrough for the third ending, just because two players is quicker. As for the game's story, a rival tribe of cavemen walk into Joe and or Mac's tent and steal all the women inside. That's it. Joe's the green one and Mac's the blue one, their most basic attack is swinging a club and throwing axes, but there are power-ups that I'll talk about as we get them. The two are constantly losing health, needing to pick up food to keep themselves alive. To be honest, I'm not a big fan of this aspect of the game, it's clearly there to kill players quicker so they have to put more coins into the machine. Obviously it's not a big deal for us as we're not playing on an arcade machine, but I imagine it'd bother me a lot if I was. After climbing up this dinosaur's back, I find the first power-up, some hot sauce. It lets you breathe fire for a few seconds. Already we find the first kidnapped cavewoman and the baby T-Rex, and it once makes it run off to be replaced by the one we were just climbing over. He spits boulders which will flatten you if you hit, but you can still move and attack. In the end we bring it down. The player who did the most damage to the boss gets a health restoring kiss from the free cavewoman while the other cries and gets nothing. Now in stage 2, which starts by a waterfall. Smashing up in this Pteranodon's egg got me the fire weapon. It lets me throw fire. Actually, you can see I was an arsehole without realising and took both fire weapons for myself. Here, we struggle with this water stream. We both thought we'd need to jump on top of it to get up to that top platform there, but no, it damages you. Instead, damage from falling in the water and getting hit by an electric catfish boosts me up there. I also end up with the teeth weapon. It's basically like the crappy knife from Castlevania, but with much worse range. Here, we get stuck at this jump until I figure out the high jump by just holding up as I jump. We'd both been doing it accidentally a couple times back in the first level, but never realised. We make it past the mountain and up to boss 2, this giant mandrake. It can plant the regular enemy version of itself, but they're not an issue. Another example of me not being a very gracious co-op player. After each piece of seed, I throw axes upwards to bounce it away from myself, and onto player 2. It's okay though, because it dies very soon after. Player 2 gets the kiss for the first and only time. I'm not letting that happen again. Why, level 2 cavewoman? Why did you give the health restore to the one with full health? Now we have the fork in the road. In the co-op playthrough, we always took the A route, while I took all the B routes playing alone. Level 2A, we're climbing these treetops, running into a lot of bees on the way. Not much I'll say about this place, it might be the shortest level in the game. The boss is a giant Pteranodon, this one can drop 2 eggs instead of 1, and it can flap its wings to lower Mac a little, but it goes down easy. And I take my rightful place as the better boss damager, and don't you forget it, Mac. Now let's swap over to my solo run and level 2B. In this playthrough I start this level with a doppelganger weapon, shooting at projections of Joe, usually with his fist out. This was my favourite weapon in the game, it's just so useful, it's quick and does a lot of damage. Like level 2A, this is another vertical level, just swapping lots of bees for lots of boulders. The big difference between 1 and 2 players is if a player dies in co-op, they just respawn and nothing happens, where if you die in a single player, you respawn at a checkpoint. This makes the game quite a bit harder if you're going through alone. The boss is still the giant Pteranodon here, aside from the location, there's no difference between it and the other fight. Speaking of the game being harder for one player, dying on the boss refills that boss's health too. Level 3 takes place on this chain of logs floating down a river. There are a lot of water streams here, it gets kind of annoying actually. When we get to this level's cavewoman, we're attacked by a lot of ichthyosaurs. The group of them as a whole is this level's boss, they're quite easy since they mostly follow a pattern and die in one hit. Player 2 is assassinated by a catfish while trying to choose the next route while I just wave goodbye. Level 3A has us descending a waterfall while being carried by two poor pteranodons. I also pick up another good weapon, the wheel. They do a lot of damage but their usefulness is held back a bit in this level as it can't perform its other function, rolling along the ground. The boss is Brachiosaurus and the wheel actually gets a chance to shine, even if it's rolling along the ground still doesn't have any use here. Shame I died and lost it though. It tried spitting piranhas at us, but with two of us throwing axes at it, it doesn't work. It still took a lot of punishment before it went down though. Now for level 3B. This one has us continuing down the river riding a plesiosaur. I also had the boomerang at this point. It is a boomerang. The level's an auto-scroller and there isn't a lot to say as since I'm on the plesiosaur at all times, the level layout never looks any different. The cruel part was dying just as the boss's platform was coming on screen and then being sent back. On a solo playthrough I'd say the Brachiosaurus is the hardest boss in the game. It's just so big. It's hard to get close enough to hit with a normal axe without being in range of its quick attacks. And when it surfaces after swimming around the bottom of the screen it takes up so much space. The game isn't totally merciless though, if you do enough damage to the boss but still die, its health won't fully be restored, I appreciate that. I do eventually get used to its patterns though and finish it off. Level 4 takes place around an erupting volcano when we both get flattened within seconds. Boulders are all over the place actually and we're on the top half of the screen so it's not like we have much space to dodge. Also look at this sneaky moving platform, going off screen just as player 2 was about to land on it. No boss here, just the choice of the next level. 4A has the same background but now there's actually lava below us, it's bursting up from the ground and everything. The boss here is an Ankylosaurus, it rolls around and shoots spiky balls but that's about it. After taking it down we're not done with this level yet, nice how there's no cavewoman. The floor crumbles and we fall into a cave that gives us a lot of food to heal for the true boss. It's a woolly mammoth. I stupidly hang around in front of it while it's waving around its trunk. It can also stamp its feet to make boulders drop from the ceiling. I do a bit of damage and oh god why? I feel horrible now, that cassique wet trunk tore off makes it even worse. then a tusk goes, and the next. At this point, killing it's a mercy. There's nothing to smile about, Joe. Let's turn our mind off it by looking at 4B. It's the only section of level 4 that also has a floor at the bottom of the screen. It's not safe down there though, since fire erupts from there and covers that half of the screen. The doppelganger destroys the Ankylosaurus, by the way. I don't want to relive this moment. Let's move on. Level 5 is in this dinosaur graveyard. I think it looks really good for a 1991 game. Definitely my favourite looking level. You can also just get struck by lightning. Player 2 accidentally uses the charged up version of the bone, making it bigger and quicker. Neither of us noticed. That whole gameplay mechanic went undiscovered by us. I'm kind of embarrassed by that, considering I went through the game 3 times in a row. The next boss is a dinosaur skeleton that spits out smaller dinosaur skulls for some reason. It was easier than the last few bosses. 5A is more dinosaur skeletons. Its boss is a giant red serpent that spits giant boulders. That's all I can say about that one. Poor player 2 actually outdamaged them this time, on the level where there's no caveman. Instead they jumped down the serpent's mouth. Level 5B had some red trees to the background, but that's the only comment I have on it. The last area is inside the serpent. We find the serpent's heart, but are also attacked by this mutated caveman. His methods of attack are jumping across the screen and spitting out centipedes. We end up splitting our attention, with me attacking the heart and player 2 fighting the caveman. The caveman keels over dead while the heart stops beating and we have 3 choices of ending. The first has the 2 surprised by a cross-dressing caveman with a mandrake who chases them through the credits. The ending I chose on my solo playthrough had the 2 instead chased off by the large caveman that got dragged off at the beginning. Also, Max shows up for this ending, though he didn't do shit this time. The third ending I just don't get. They find exactly what they set out for and are now running afraid of them. Is it because only 4 women were taken from their tent at the beginning and 7 is just too much? Either way, that was Caveman Ninja, another shorter one, about half an hour each playthrough. Supposedly there was one more power-up, a lightning weapon, but I somehow never got it. But I did enjoy this game. Not enough to not get a little bored in my third consecutive playthrough, but it was still fine.